It is my great pleasure to introduce today's speaker, Dr. Laurance Doyle. Since 1987, Dr. Doyle has been the principal investigator with the SETI Institute in Mountain View, California, where his main projects have been the photometric detection of extrasolar planets. Who knows what that means? Okay, good, if you do, that's good. Okay. So the photometric detection of extrasolar planets, the application of information theory to animal communications, and the application of quantum physics to solve certain astronomical problems. He has been a visiting lecturer at the University of California, Santa Cruz, teaching classes on life in the universe and light and optics, and he has about 100 refereed papers in the scientific literature. He was a member of the NASA Kepler mission science team with responsibility for detection of extrasolar planets around double star systems, and they found Kepler 16b, which of course was nicknamed Tatooine. Because it's like Tatooine, yeah. So, yeah. And that was the first detection of a circumbinary planet. Laurance has taught quantum physics, thermodynamics, introductory astronomy, the history of science, and Native American history here at Principia College. And he is the founding director of the Institute for the Metaphysics of Physics at Principia College, working on starting the new field of quantum astronomy. I don't know if you're going to dabble in that tonight or not, but we'll see. But with the upcoming one-minute total solar eclipse over the Principia Lower, Middle, and Upper School in St. Louis at 11:41 a.m., mark your watches, 11:41 a.m. Central Time on August 21st, 2017, he will then have spent a total of 20 minutes altogether in the moon's shadow. More than, I think, anyone else here in this room. So it's my great pleasure to introduce Dr. Laurance Doyle.
I can get it better myself.
Working okay? See if this works. Yep, good. Can we dim the lights a mite? Thanks. Okay, well, solar eclipses are probably the most dramatic, safe thing that nature does. I've seen nature do a lot of things, and solar eclipses are very dramatic and very unpreventable. This lady wrote me once that she couldn't make this eclipse in June. Was there anything I could do? And it's like, well, so I wrote her back that if we took all our nuclear weapons and exploded them on the right side of the moon, we can make a crater big enough to delay the eclipse by about a quarter of a second. Did that help? So there's an eclipse where the maximum duration is in Carbondale, and over the upper school, it'll last for a little over a minute, and you should not miss a total solar eclipse. No one I've ever talked to said, gosh, I'm sorry I saw that. It never happens. Although I was in Mongolia, and they were gonna go in the yurts and the gurs and pound pots and pans and paint their faces black. And I said, no, you want to see this. So I handed them eclipse glasses and we saw the eclipse. And afterward, they were crying and shaking my hand. And it was the most emotional eclipse I ever went to. And they were thanking me for the eclipse. And it's like, any time. Okay, so there's lots to watch for. I've had a group of 12 people working on one experiment during a solar eclipse, and four of them, after we trained several times, four of them forgot to take the lens cap off their camera. So you have to really practice. It may seem silly and dumb, but when a solar eclipse happens, you just go, wow. Okay, so what to look for? Well, solar eclipses is when the moon goes in front of the sun. Now that didn't always happen, because the moon's 1/400th the size of the sun, and right now, even though it's moving out about an inch a year, it happens to be 1/400th the distance. So it fits perfectly over the sun. And if it weren't for this perfect fit, we wouldn't have discovered the corona, or been able to test relativity, as I'll talk about a little later, or been able to discover the element helium, perhaps. So okay, now lunar eclipse, that's when the moon goes into the Earth's shadow. Now, solar eclipses occur more often than lunar, But they're rarer because the shadow is so small, within 100 miles-ish, you can see the shadow. You can be in the shadow of the moon. Lunar eclipses, everybody gets to see it because the moon goes into the Earth's shadow, and it turns the moon copper. Now, why is that? It's because there's refraction or bending of the light from the sunrise and from the sunset of the Earth onto the moon when the moon moves into the shadow. And so it's the projection. What you're seeing here is a projection of the sunrise and sunset, which of course takes out the blue light because the sky's blue, but lets the red light through, as we know from sunsets. Columbus saved his third voyage with a lunar eclipse. There's that old story about the guy that's taken by cannibals and he's in the pot and he's worried and he says, well, wait a second, there's an eclipse today. I'll tell the natives that I'll block out the sun and they'll let me go. So this one native dances close to him and he goes, so when are you planning to eat me? And the native says, right after the eclipse. Oh well, can't win them all. But Columbus did win it. He said, I'm going to turn the moon to blood, and the natives were impressed and gave him all the supplies he needed to leave. And I think that's where Connecticut Yankee in King Arthur's Court, where Mark Twain may have gotten the idea. Okay, and there's partial solar eclipses. If you stay here at ELSA, somebody asked me, what did I see? And you'll see a partial solar eclipse. It won't get dark, the stars won't come out. You won't see the glow, you won't see Bailey's beads, you won't see the diamond ring effect, you won't see the emerald tiara or an eclipse rainbow or any of that stuff. But if you look underneath trees, you will see little crescents because the leaves act as little pinhole cameras. So while the eclipse is about to take place, you should get pictures of crescents. And also, you can hold your hand out and the shadow of your hand will show webbing so you can tell people came from the sea, because it gives you a webbed hand. So it's a lot of fun. There's lots of stuff you can do. Then there's annual eclipses, and those are a few where the moon happens to be farther and the sun closer so that it doesn't cover up the sun completely. So that gives you an idea. An annular eclipse gives you an idea how close this balance is that we get total solar eclipses. There are eclipses on other planets. This is Ganymede and its shadow on Jupiter. But it doesn't cover up the whole thing, clearly. So. just to be clear, an occultation is when a big thing moves in front of a small thing. A transit is when a small thing moves in front of a big thing. And an eclipse is when two things of about the same size move in front of each other. That's just the general rule. Transit was something that Captain Cook was not sent to the Pacific to discover Hawaii. So that doesn't make sense, right? You can't send him to discover Hawaii if he hasn't discovered Hawaii. It's like getting a World War I shirt. If it says World War I, it's not a World War I shirt. Or an 8 BC coin, you know? Don't believe it. It's not true. So he went to actually observe a Venus transit. And what that would give them in England is a clue to navigation, but also it gives the scale of the solar system. So they had everything worked out according to Kepler's third law, but they didn't know what the scale was until they could measure the time it took for Venus to transit the sun. So Captain Cook, one of his main reasons being sent to discover stuff, was actually an astronomical reason, a transit. And this is Regulus, I think, and the moon goes over stars occasionally, and you can measure the sizes of stars using this method. And that's what it looks like. It suddenly starts to black out, and then the diffraction pattern of the star looks like that. This is a measure of the brightness and how it this is an emerging occultation. Now, this is actually an eclipse of the moon in front of the sun, but it was taken by the Stereo spacecraft, which is 4.4 times farther away from the sun than the Earth. So that's the kind of eclipses you'll get if you're too much farther than the Earth is. And then the Kepler spacecraft looked for transits of planets. And it's found 4,000 or so more planets. So it's the most successful planet finder in history. And what it does is it looks for the dips in the brightness as the star moves in front of the, sorry, as the planet moves in front of the star, you can see the dips in brightness. Now, there are people didn't know there were circumbinary planets. Half the theorists said it couldn't happen, and half said it could, that the two stars would shake up the protoplanetary disk forming planets and cause them to form planets sooner, and others said it would dissipate the disk. But now there's no doubt, there's actually 14 circumbinary planets known now, but two haven't been published yet. Okay, well, what can we look for at this eclipse that's coming up? Well, just before the sun disappears, there's something called the diamond ring effect. There's kind of a jewelry motif. And this is a picture of the diamond ring effect. And it's okay to take a picture of this as long as you're not looking through optics. Fortunately, most people have digital cameras now and they can look at the CCD. But before, I'd say everybody with lenses, come close to me. And I've blocked my hand in front of their eye when we come out of totality sometimes. The diamond ring effect is really pretty, and there's also Bailey's beads, discovered in 1836. And what there's these beads that appear around the edge of the moon just before totality. What could that be? Anybody have an idea? Those are all great guesses. Solar flares, diffraction, yes. But what they are, this is the sun shining through the valleys of the moon. So each of these is a valley, and this, while the moon's blocking the sun, the valleys are letting through some of the sunshine. So Bailey's beads are a way of, it was a way, but way back in the 19th century, of getting the depths of some of the lunar valleys. Okay, now here, everybody's going to be the first one to do this. Nobody has ever gotten a good picture of shadow bands. That's why this is a drawing. And for more than 100 years, people have tried. What are shadow bands? Shadow bands are when the moon's starting to cover the sun gets so skinny in that direction that it starts to twinkle like a star. So it's a turbulent air cells. And the ones closest to you start the twinkling. And then as it gets narrower and narrower, the ones higher up in the atmosphere with a smaller angular extent start the twinkling, and since that's the jet stream, the twinkling speeds up. So it looks like this, but it's more like this. And then, and the reason it's so hard to get a picture of is the contrast is only about 1%, and the scale's changing, so a long exposure doesn't help because this is going to superimpose on this, and you're not going to get a good picture. If you do, I guarantee the cover of Sky and Telescope magazine. So if you want to try, cameras have gotten a lot better, so let me know. I'll be sure and guarantee you'll make the cover of Sky and Telescope. Shadow bands are kind of like the wavy patterns you see at the bottom of a swimming pool. So take a long exposure of that, and you'll get this blur. And that's because they're non-repeating in some sense. Okay. Now, one of the things you want to look for, you look for the crescents underneath the trees, and you look for shadow bands, but you also want to look for the moon's shadow zooming at you. So it'll be moving across the landscape at about 1,000 miles an hour, and you see it coming, and then it gets cold, all the animals go to sleep, stars come out, there's a gold glow around the horizon, and it's just a different Earth. So there's the shadow of the moon zooming across the landscape. In 2002, most of the people in our group were amateur astronomers, and they were packing up, and I kept watching. And it was below 15 degrees on the horizon, which is not an optimum place to see an eclipse. Our eclipse is going to be at 11:41, so it'll be way up nice in the sky. But near the horizon, I kept looking, and I saw this emerald halo appear around the moon as it went across the sun. So keeping with Bailey's beads and the diamond ring effect and all, we call it the Emerald Tiara. And I sent it in to Sky and Telescope magazine, and I thought it was just a note to the editor, but they wrote it up. Steve O'Meara wrote it up, and here we get credit for discovering the Emerald Tiara. And this is just a small one. The one I saw was about like that. So now everybody sees it. They discuss it. They said, it's like saying, have you seen a yellow Volkswagen today? Well, now that you said that, I see him everywhere. And they discuss that. Everybody's seeing the Emerald Tiara. But the point is that there's still stuff to discover. After millions of people looking for thousands of years, you can still find something new. But one of the reasons it was new was because we are looking on the horizon. It has to be below 15 degrees if you're going to see an Emerald Tiara. So let's see. During totality, you're going to see these guys, solar prominences. And they're going to be superimposed on this oyster, kind of silky. If you take white silk and you do this with the white silk sheets, you're going to see what the streamers and the corona look like during totality. And also, though, you're going to see these scarlet flares that are prominences, these guys. And it's really incredibly beautiful. It's really amazing. Temperature will drop about 20 degrees. And all the animals, like I said, will go to sleep. The birds will go into the trees and all that. And then they'll come out really rapidly. I was in Zambia, and we were chasing an eclipse in Kafue National Park. And we came to the border, and these men stand out with machine guns. And you're supposed to stop and chat for 15 minutes because it's only polite. So we chatted, and I noticed that the bullets were too big for the guns. But, you know, it looked good. And I didn't know what to talk about, so I said, you know about the eclipse? And they said, yeah. And I said, you know, the chickens are going to roost in the middle of the day. They're going to go in and think it's nighttime. And then after the eclipse, they'll come back out and wander around and be all confused and that sort of thing. Well, we drove on through a fire. Some poachers had started a fire. And we came to the edge of the Kafue River, and we had to cross it. And these two guys came out, and they said, do you want us to call the boat? Okay. So, unbelievably, they went up on this hill and started to drum. And it's like, wow, I felt like Dr. Livingston, I presume. And the boat came called by the drums. That was really neat. They went and saw the total solar eclipse, and then driving back, we got to Kafue border, and these guys said, I heard him say to the combi, I was driving one of the six or seven combis, he said, where's Laurance, Doyle? And Eddie said, well, he's the third car back. So they come running up. They shake my hand with both their hands. They say, you are a great scientist. The chickens did exactly what you said. So I figured if the astronomy gig doesn't work out, I can make it as a chicken psychologist in Zambia. So it's been a lot of interesting experiences. The medicine guy in Zambia didn't think it would happen, and he was kind of afraid. And it's amazing how many people are kind of freaked out by eclipses, more than you would think. You overcorrect. But so there's also the solar chromosphere, and this is what it looks like. And it basically is the very skin of the sun, and it flashes. It mostly flashes green. And that'll introduce another discovery we made at an eclipse during rain. And you ordinarily wouldn't go to a place with rain, but there are some eclipse phenomena with rain that are really interesting, which I'll show you in a minute. So sunspots, you'll see a lot of sunspots because I have a solar filter and we'll be watching the sun as the moon goes across. And of course, the sun is a dwarf star. It's about 80 billion hydrogen bombs exploding every second. And the sunshine we're getting now was made inside the sun a million years ago. But it took a million years to get to the surface. Then it's 8.5 minutes to Earth. But the sunshine right out there today, when you walk outside, just tell yourself, somebody's planning ahead because this was made a million years ago. So, this is just a reminder that we're mostly photosynthetically based ecosystem here on this planet, and that the maximum receptivity of plants matches the maximum receptivity of our eyes in the yellow and or greenish yellow. And that's the same thing with these with water plants. And our maximum sensitivity at night matches the blue reflected by the full moon. So in other words, an alien wouldn't have any trouble looking at this plant and these plants and you and saying, you're from Earth. I don't even have to take your DNA. You're from Earth because your eyes are sensitive to that star and your night vision sensitive to that moon. And of course, a lot of other critters are sensitive to the cycles of the moon. The moon is tilted on its rotation axis, its orbital axis, from the Earth 5 degrees. That's why we don't get an eclipse every month. We have to wait for the nodes to line up. Like, imagine a hula hoop. Does everybody know what a hula hoop is? Have hula hoops made a comeback? I don't know. Anyway, if you hold two of them and you incline one 5 degrees from the other and roll a marble around it, it will not occult, it will not go across your belt buckle until the nodes, you line up the nodes where you're holding the hula hoop, right? Then every pass will cause an eclipse. So there are eclipse seasons called sorrow cycles, named after by the Greeks, basically. And so the moon also stabilizes the Earth's rotation. On Mars, the rotation axis flips. It can flip up to 90 degrees in a few million years. But on Earth, we have the moon stabilizing our orbit. So we have seasons year after year after year, the same way, pretty much. Okay. There was an annular eclipse of 2136, and the Chinese astronomers Hai and Ho failed to predict it. And so apparently the Chinese expected to be able to predict eclipses way back in 2136 BC, which is pretty neat. I guess they were hanged, but they're still famous. And this is the shadow of that eclipse, where it went across China. You can see China's right there. So in other words, humans predicting eclipses goes way back. Now here are some I'll just mention. It's one eclipse is mentioned in the Odyssey. They had a double dawn eclipse back in 898 BC. Tales of Miletus, or Thales of Miletus, however you're supposed to pronounce it, predicted the first eclipse, at least the year. And he was the first in Greek history, at least, to predict a solar eclipse. We'll come back to that because, there are certain roles that eclipses have played in history. Jesus, the time of Jesus' crucifixion, the sky got dark, but it got dark for longer than a total solar eclipse. The maximum solar eclipse is 7 minutes or so, 7.5. So we don't really know. We just know that there was an eclipse on November 24th, 29 AD. And then solar prominences are first described. The first comet was discovered during an eclipse because it got dark. Muhammad's birth eclipse is pretty famous in that community. The first description of the corona, which is the atmosphere of the sun, which is millions of degrees. 968 AD, and the visit to Genghis Khan. We'll go into this one in a little more detail, but each of these would be a talk, could be a talk. Okay, well, Tales of Miletus predicted in 585 an eclipse, and it stopped a five-year war. The Lydians, and this is a Lydian, stopped fighting with the Medes, and these are Medes. And the Lydian is holding Mead, but the Medes are holding spears. It's kind of confusing, but so this is actually one of the most accurately documented ancient battles because of the eclipse. But also, they both took it as a sign, hey, maybe we better make peace. That's Herodotus, I mean, here. He was like the ancient historian. Well, not to leave out the New World, the Maya were, of course, predicting eclipses. They have 400 million years worth of eclipses calculations encoded in this. See this guy here? Encoded in this 30-foot stele. 400 million years worth of eclipse calculations. So they were supreme mathematicians. You can see the dots are ones and the lines are fives. And this is the ones place. This is the 20s place. So we have base 10. But they didn't wear shoes, so I assume that's why they did base 20. You could keep going. And so these are numbers, the ones place, the 20s place, what would be the next place? 20 times 20, right? So that would be the 400th place and the 8,000th place. But the Maya, being what they are, bless their hearts, they decided, well, that's 400 is pretty close to 360. So we'll make this the 1's place, the 20's place, the 360's place, which means the next one is the 7200's place. So you get the idea. Messed up the decipherment of the numbers of Maya counting for a long time because they made that little switcheroo there, making that the 360's place. But anyway, there's images of the sun and Venus and so on. So you can look at the Spanish basically burnt all the books except for 4. And from these 4, we learn a lot of the Mayan astronomy. Their calendar was based on the orbit of Venus. Okay, now let's jump ahead to more modern eclipses. Captain Cook's eclipse, when he was commissioned to observe Venus, and that was on August 5th, 1766. Now Tecumseh and Tenskwatawa is his brother who was the medicine guy. Tecumseh was almost the United States Genghis Khan. He almost united the tribes to repel the new folks from Europe. But Harrison, General Harrison, who was to become President Harrison, said to Tecumseh's brother, okay, if you're a medicine guy, predict an eclipse. Well, nobody knows where he got it, but Tecumseh's brother predicted the eclipse of June 16th, 1806 exactly. I don't know if he's talking to some astronomers or what, or maybe he figured it out, I don't know. All I know is that that was the wrong thing for Harrison to say if he wanted to impress the Indians. So instead, Tecumseh got a big following, and this was an important eclipse in history, in U.S. history. Bailey's beads are first described in 1836, as I mentioned, and the first photograph was in 1860. Now, when was photography invented? About 1839. So, I often wonder why there isn't a movie of Mrs. Eddy or a recording. The technology was there. Anyway, so the first photograph of an eclipse. The Zulu War, Isandlwana, the British thought the eclipse would help them, but it didn't. The Zulus took it as a sign that they were going to win, and they did. This was Shaka Zulu, the leader that kind of proposed real war as opposed to fake war or counting coup or something. Then there's the Einstein-Eddington eclipse. This made Einstein famous overnight, May 29th, 1919. I'll go into a little more detail there. Then there was the New York eclipse, which, when I wrote this, was the largest science experiment. But since then, SETI at home, I think, has had a couple million people. So, but an eclipse went over New York City, and people were asked to describe what they saw. Most of them said, I saw the stars come out and all. But somewhere around 32nd and 33rd Street, people saw partial eclipses. And so it was the best determination of the tidal effects of the orbit of the moon up to that time, because you had a million people reporting data points. And then the Kuiper Airborne Observatory flew for 76 minutes in 1973 across Africa, across Kenya and every place, staying in the shadow of the moon. So anyway, there's lots more eclipses. I just want to get you an idea. The eclipses have played a role in history. Okay, 1916. Einstein predicts that the stars are going to be bent so that an object here will be bent around so it looks like it's there. So you can see that it has the effect of spreading something out so that warp space-time would spread things out more than if the sun did not bend space-time. So what Einstein did is he basically got rid of the notion of Newton's, of gravity, some magic force. And they asked Newton, what's the magic force? And he says, I form no hypothesis. So he was saying, like, you got me, is how you would say it now. So Einstein came up with the idea that gravity is just bent space-time, and Eddington tested that. And here's an actual plate with some of the stars on it that was used. I got this image from Lick Observatory, which also did this sort of thing. And there's Sir Arthur Eddington. Now, this was the birth, when he said Einstein was right, cosmology was born, so as a new scientific field. Okay, let's see. Oh, yeah. We can determine, I'll go into detail a little bit here, Earth's rotation rate is changing. And that's because people are dragging their feet. No, that's not it. It's because their rivers are making rocks round, especially the Bering Sea. And that all has the effect of slowing the Earth's rotation rate down. If you take an egg and it's raw, spin it, grab it, and then let go right away, it'll start to spin again because the yolk's still going. So you can see that there's some friction there. If, by the way, if you have a hard-boiled egg and you want to test it, spin it and it'll sit up on the long axis. So that's the way you tell. Of course, if it spins off and it's a raw egg, your mom's going to get married. So a lot of aspects of the sun have been discovered by eclipses, general theory of relativity, and lots of other science is still being done today. If you have any questions about what these are, I'm happy to. It's a little technical. Okay, now there was an eclipse in 136 BC, and the moon's shadow went over the city of Babylon. And you say, well, wait a second, here's west, here's east, so the Earth is rotating this way, from here to here. And so there's, if it's rotating at a constant rate, that's where the shadow should have gone. But the Babylonians reported the shadow was over there. So how is that? It gets a little tricky and you can get yourself pretty confused, but the basic idea is that Babylon was, it should have been there in that eclipse, right? But the Earth's rotation had slowed down. So that where it should be from current observation of the Earth's rate of rotation, then it should not have seen the eclipse, right? But if the Earth was rotating faster in the past and was slowing down, then Babylon will have gotten farther than it should have because the Earth was rotating faster back then, right? Does that make sense? So the fact that Babylon was not there but here, we'll put it this way, this was the whole Earth was rotating back to here, means that it's slowing down. And the Earth's rotation rate is still slowing down. So we know from this 136 BC eclipse that the rate of Earth slowing down. Well, it turns out that in 1220, there was a Taoist monk, Cheng Chun, who was summoned to visit the court of Genghis Khan. And he saw a total solar eclipse on the way. And a Chinese historian got together with an astrophysicist, and they used this data to calculate the rotation rate of the slowdown of the Earth. So here's where the eclipse path went, right past here in 1221. And here's the Carolyn River where Cheng Chun was supposed to have stopped, but he said, I was always south of the river. Well, he would have missed the eclipse unless he was here in this bend. So we know pretty accurately where he was. Here's what he wrote. His chronicler wrote this. His party proceeded first in a roughly northern direction in order to visit Prince Tamuga, who is Genghis Khan's younger brother. On May 15th, he reached Lake Hulun. Hulunur is at the place where the River Carolyn overflows. So we have that record, and then we see, okay, well, if the Earth was slowing down this much, he would have seen it from here, or from there, or probably not from there. So we know the slowdown of the Earth is probably the middle one. And he wrote this, on the first day of the fifth month, at noon, the sun was eclipsed and it was total. All the stars were then seen. Okay, that's for sure. He may have said total and we weren't sure, but if the stars came out, it has to be total. Short while later, the brightness returned. At that time, we were on the southern bank of the river, this side. The eclipse began at the southwest of the sun and reappeared from the northeast. Okay, so what is good is this? Well, these guys wrote this paper, and they basically showed that knowing where Cheng Chun was and that he had a total solar eclipse, you could figure out how much the Earth's rotation rate had slowed down. So we know about the tidal history of the Earth. What that means is that the dinosaurs had a 21-hour day. So if you feel rushed, well, here's the eclipse spot we chose in Mongolia, and there's our tents, and we're way in western Mongolia. And there's the, I forget what lake that is, and these guys showed up with golden eagles. So they had horses and golden eagles and the ear flaps and stuff. And there's our camp. There's some gurs, but there's our some of our, and of course there are cattle and yaks and things like that. And this is about 10,000 feet. Neat place. I think if I was going to start a business, I would go to Mongolia and start a hovercraft business, because there's no reason they shouldn't have hover yurts. And they just hover and zzz down to new pasture. I think that'd be great. Why build roads when you don't have to? You know how Africa will never have telephone poles? Same reason. And there's some nice musicians. They and their colleagues, some of the men did throat singing. Have you ever heard Mongolian throat singing? Get two or three different voices at once. And of course, I said, I know what your songs are gonna about. And they go, you do? And I go, yeah, I love my horse. And they all laughed because that's like 90% of the songs are called I Love My Horse. So, here's some of the Babylonian eclipses and on down to the present, you know, to Islamic eclipses. And you can see there's a general trend of the Earth to slow down. And that's why we know the dinosaurs had a 21-hour day. Okay, Australia. There was an eclipse across Australia, and we went, and this is where we discovered the Emerald Tiara. And I just wanted to show you that if you're in Australia trying to track down the eclipse in the 1920s, it's different than getting in your car and tootling over to the upper school. This is the conditions. I found these old plates about the expedition to Australia in 1922, bless their hearts. 34 tons of equipment, and they're trying to test the theory of relativity. And I just thought I'd throw in a couple. Here's what their telescopes look like. I'm going to bring a little 8-inch telescope, about like this, with a solar filter. She'll be able to look at the corona and lots of neat stuff during totality, but hopefully we can hook up a camera so everybody can see the flares and stuff. But anyway, you get the idea. These guys are real dedicated. Sometimes it got clouded out, or in this case, it almost got dusted out. So anyway, it's just good to look and think, oh, I think I can make it from ELSA to St. Louis. And I'll bring the photography, I'll bring the telescope. So there they are, setting up. How can you tell this is not yet total? Is there anything in these pictures that tells you that totality hasn't happened yet? What? Is it this picture? Do you see crescents underneath the tree? That's what tells me it isn't total yet. Also, guys standing around. Okay, so the Astronomer Royal in 1923. So they were the ones that showed that Einstein was correct. And this is how we went to an eclipse in Australia. Reading a newspaper to the last minute and having, you know, whatever. So things have changed, and the one in ELSA is going to be even easier to see. Now, what happens? When the moon covers up the sun, there's the corona. And if its sunspot cycle is high, it'll be oblong and look like a giant eyeball looking down at you. It'll be symmetric if the sunspot is at a minimum. And then you can take a spectrum just before totality, and this is what it looks like. It's dominated by this light lime green iron line. And this is iron that's ionized 14 times. So it's really hot. Okay, so what is the, why is all that interesting? Well, the corona is made up of high-energy electrons, and its spectra turns out to be pink. So I saw this in the sky in Australia when the clouds parted and we saw totality, but this sundoggy rainbow thing was lime green and pink, and the yellow just started to come back. I was staring at it, and I was messing with telescopes, and I said, somebody get a picture of it. And Catherine Jackson got it, one of our tourists. And you're saying, well, look, that's lime green and pink. Well, that's an eclipse rainbow. I think it's the first picture of one. And it's not as good as I'd liked it, because it was totally pink and lime green. Looked like watermelon tourmaline. Have you ever seen a mineral called watermelon tourmaline? Anyway, so we discovered we got maybe the first eclipse rainbow. Why hasn't somebody done that before? Because why would you go to a rainforest to watch an eclipse? Which I was asking myself as well. But that's where it was going over, Cairns, Australia. So that's an eclipse rainbow. That's our second discovery of. So there's always stuff to discover. You discover something new, I'll help you get it in the literature. So here we are. Eclipses are great. Lots to look at in all directions. And I'll rehearse it when we get close to the eclipse. But first thing you do is you notice the crescent, and you look under the tree, and you do your webbed hand thing. Then you watch for the shadow of the moon coming across. And then you look at the ground for Bailey's beads. And you all see, sorry, for the shadow bands. And you'll see it change, because the eye's very good at that sort of thing. But if you can get a picture, try. And then you'll see Bailey's beads and the diamond ring effect. And then you'll see totality. And you want to see prominences. And you want to see the corona. And one guy in Baja, when I was there at an eclipse, he said he was going to look at the sky and describe what he saw scientifically. And so he used a tape recorder because he didn't want to take his eyes off the sky. Well, he played it for us. He was humble enough to play it for us. 6 minutes of, oh, wow. Oh, gee. Look at that. Oh, my gosh. There isn't one scientific observation in 6 minutes. So I thought I'd try the same thing with our students on the eclipse. And so I give them a page to write their data in, and that's what we got. And that's, I think, is a sketch of the eclipse. It came as close as possible. So anyway, yeah, be sure and take the lens cap off your camera, etc. It's very distracting, very. So there we are at Hippocamp in Zambia, making plans for getting across the Kafue River. This is Eddie Frank, and he owns the Tusker Trail Company, and he's used to traveling in Africa. He's an Afrikaans guy. But he got this idea that we had to be exactly in the middle, absolutely. So we had to, I mean, we could have been 10 or 15 miles away and still done fine, but he had to put us right smack. So we were navigating, and I was using sextants, and anyway, we made it to the top of this hill, and we were smack in the middle of the eclipse, the actual maximum duration. So I kind of talked him out of that, where it might be easier to get within a few miles, and you don't have to call a boat by drums and things. So, just to end, nobody's going to miss the eclipse, right? You don't want to miss it. If anybody feels disappointed, let me know, because you won't be. So I've suggested to Kelly Petacolis that we do a lifelong learning trip to Antarctica and watch this eclipse, which is, interestingly enough, 7 minutes, 33.1 seconds. That's the absolute maximum you can have an eclipse on Earth. So it's worth going to Antarctica. And Antarctica is pretty cool, too. So we'll see what happens. Okay, thanks a lot. 2021. By the way, this is 2021, so there's plenty of time to get ready.
So 2021, book your tickets now. Mm-hmm. Do you want to take any questions?
Yeah. We have time for questions, if you like.
Great.
We're recording this, so we'll wait for a mic.
I'm wondering, I was told that you should not look at the sun during a solar eclipse because your eyes will go blind. Someone said, get some welder's glasses. Not the face mask, but the glasses. What should we do about that?
Well, Joe ordered 2,000 glasses.
Oh,
eclipse
Joe!
Glasses, so we'll be ready for everybody. Yeah, and they have a star cluster design. I think Nikki picked out the star cluster design. On one side it says Principia, August 21st, 2017, total solar eclipse. The other side says, suns and planets teach grand lessons, Mary Baker Eddy. So they're souvenirs. So the thing is, you don't want to look at the sun anyway when it's just out. And you don't want to use welder's glasses because although they take out some of the UV, they don't take out all the IR, infrared. So get bona fide eclipse glasses. Or you can make a pinhole and turn your back to the sun and project it onto a piece of white paper. I passed those out once at an eclipse, and people were going like, ugh. It's like, no, you're missing a concept. But yeah, and then you take the glasses off at totality, and then I'll count down, and we'll have local people counting down, and we'll leave 1 second to put your glasses back on. And anybody with lenses, I just want to make sure they're close by or somebody's close by, is going to block it, because you don't want to be looking through a telephoto lens when the sun comes out. So we'll count down and everything. And most people are not going to be using direct lenses, which is great. That's really simplified my life when we've done these eclipses.
So I forgot the name of what you see, the kind of rippling.
Oh, shadow bands.
Shadow bands. Okay. Is there a way to turn shadow bands into audio? Because then on live, you can differentiate a difference in frequency of audio far better than you can visually see. We see 60 hertz, I think, and we hear about 250 hertz or something along those lines.
It'll get up to maybe 10 hertz before they disappear, before totality.
But I mean, if you could hear it, you could hear the differences.
I agree. There's you could use photomultiplier tubes spread out in a square and then convert that to sound. That'd be great. If you wanted to make the sound of shadow bands, I think it'd be really interesting because it starts out, I would imagine it would start out like a like that.
Yeah.
So it'd be interesting. It wouldn't be the same monotonous. So yeah, if you want to do that, let me know if I can help.
Okay, and then the other thing is, I don't know whether people know here, last time there was a solar eclipse that went only across the United States, you know, all the way across from coast to coast. Yeah. The last time that happened. Does anybody know what year that was?
I do.
1776.
Only across the U.S.
And it only went across the U.S.
But even in the continental U.S. at all, has been 38 years. The continental U.S. has not even seen a total solar eclipse for 38 years. So much less exactly across it. That's neat. Thanks. I didn't put up all the eclipses. They're everywhere when you start looking at them. Somebody else?
You may have said this and I may have missed it, but why is our eclipse only a minute and then the one down in Antarctica is 7 minutes?
Oh, it varies because of the orbit of the moon is not completely circular, nor is our orbit around the sun. So sometimes the sun is closer, sometimes farther. So that means that the size of the moon compared to the sun is a little bit varying. So the one in Antarctica will not probably show Bailey's beads because the moon will be so close, it'll last for a long time and the sun will not peak through the valleys. So I wouldn't expect Bailey's beads in Antarctica, but you will see them here. It goes over the upper school, the lower middle upper school. What should I call that? The other school, the Principia school. It goes over and it'll last about a little over a minute. If you go farther south, you can get 2 minutes. But the barbecue's at the school, so. Did you get a, yeah.
Just to follow up on the idea of in 1776, was it that the eclipse went across the United States? Was the questioner asking, taking into account, what does across the United States mean? Does it mean in modern terms as in coast to coast, Or was it just like perhaps the length of Pennsylvania?
Yeah, I think it was coast to coast. Yeah. It was pre-Louisiana Purchase, so technically it wasn't the U.S., but it was. Yeah. Okay. But it was to be the continental U.S. How many people are going to the eclipse? Uh-oh. Okay. Thank you. Good. Are there other questions? No other questions?
Lawrence.
Oh, yeah.
Is it possible to take a video of the eclipse in color?
Yes. Yeah, it's beautiful. I have some videos of eclipses. The variation, though, between the diamond ring effect and totality is about 1 million in brightness. So you're going to have to work at it if you want a nice, smooth transition. Otherwise, you'll get a beautiful sun about to be covered up and then black. Or, you know, so be on your toes. You've got about half a second to make the adjustment. But a factor of 1 million is a lot, even from diamond ring to totality. I can help with eclipse photography ideas and stuff, whatever you want to try and do, even conversion to sound if you want. We converted some of the Kepler stars that are eclipsing to sound. So we have software to do that if you're interested.
Have you tried to video the shadow bands?
Yeah, they don't show up. They smear. And that's the reason is the scale is changing. It's like a bunch of boxes separated like this. You know, it's like a bunch of seagulls flying between you and the sun, changing to a bunch of butterflies flying between you and the sun, and then a bunch of gnats going twice as fast. And by the time you get a chance to get a decent exposure, it's all smeared. That's why they're so challenging. Sky and Telescope published something a couple years ago, and it was this faint variation on the clouds, maybe, as this guy tried to get him a picture of the clouds showing shadow bands. And their caption said shadow bands, and most people said, boy, we sure wish, but no. So maybe you're the first. Equipment has improved. But figure out a way to do different scales that are changing their rhythm. I don't really know how to do that myself yet. Or people have put down photomultiplier tubes and recorded them going across them, but no photograph yet. Any more?
Uh-huh. Okay, so what's traffic?
Oh, yeah. Well,
I would just guess there's going to be a massive group going to where the epicenter, so to speak, is.
Yeah, the epicenter or the maximum duration
right.
Is Carbondale. So everybody and their cousins are going to be flying into St. Louis. If you're planning to come to the eclipse and you need to fly into St. Louis, I would book ahead of time a few days. All the Carbondale hotels and motels are booked. And amateur astronomers that follow, that's one warning I should have given you. Don't put it this way. I know people, maybe 25% of the people that go to solar eclipses spend the rest of their vacations, the rest of their lives chasing eclipses. So there's a warning. You may wind up chasing eclipses. I know I did.
There was an article that said there could be up to 5 million people converging on the St. Louis area because of
yeah.
the eclipse.
Oh, really? 5 million?
Yeah, and that seems unbelievable to me, but there's a lot of things that are unbelievable that we
well, the eclipse is unbelievable.
And the eclipse is actually, August 21st is our first day of new student orientation. And so, thanks to Laurance, we were able to coordinate that very well. He said, you know, could we have it on Sunday? He said, well, I'll give you Monday. So NPO, our new parents orientation, will be over. But sometimes we try to shoo the parents away on Sunday and you know, so we can start new student orientation. If you're here dropping children off, I'm guessing we'll figure out a way to accommodate you at the eclipse on Monday. So that's when it's going to. And the last time, what I'm understanding, I don't know if you told me this, the last time we had a solar eclipse in St. Louis, it was in like 1500 and something.
It was, yeah, I'll have to look it up.
So if you miss this one, it's going to be a while.
Well, fortunately, it's going to be 2 years.
Oh, okay.
So.
In St. Louis?
Yeah, something's going to come around the southeast.
Oh.
I'll have to look it up. Okay. But yeah, fortunately, you're going to get another chance. But don't miss this one, because once you see it, really honest, nobody says, gosh, I'm sorry I saw that. You know, the birds and everything went to sleep. It got cold. Stars came out, a golden glow. The moon rushing across the, you know, the moon shadow, the corona, the scarlet prominences. And, you know, the streaming corona and the beads and the diamond ring and all. It's like, gosh, why did I come here? You know, that never happens. You're going to love it. But you may get addicted, and that's okay.
All right. Well, thank you very much. We're going to wrap up now so we can get on to our next activities. Thanks.
Thank you.